Namaskar, all of you. This session is actually a continuation of the last session. We are picking up some matter from the last session and proceeding further. First of all, as we were discussing with the thought matter in asanas, how do we have a thought matter in asanas? Because usually the process is that we do asanas, set right the body, set right the mind, set right the breath. Now, that means we'll get just an experience of a good asana, proper asana. We'll just get an experience. But where is the thought matter? To be getting the thought matter, actually we are missing a very major component of an asana, which I want to highlight today. That will sufficiently give the thought matter for us. Rather than just going for an asana and going for an experience of quietude, placidity, equanimity, equilibrium, sublimity. So rather than going for mere experience, we'll have to see that we generate thought matter. So for that purpose, you just can't set right body, mind and breath. We'll have to bring in a kriya, which is so important in Adhyatma. In Adhyatma, the constitution of Adhyatmic act is by Kaya, Vacha, Manasa. Kaya means body, body parts, body organs, body matter. Then comes vacha, speech, and then manas. So in our introductory kind of instructions, we went for setting right body set, mind set, breath set, body set addressal, breath set addressal, mind set addressal, and that's how we were trying to accomplish an anasana. But Adhyatma says that vachik kriya is very important. Vachik kriya means speechly act. Now usually the speechly act is only with the teachers, when they conduct classes, when they teach, when they instruct. So only teachers are in speechly act. The students are hardly in speechly act. More often they come with sealed mouths. And then they participate in the classes. And then they say, I am participating wholly and completely. Adhyatma analyzes all acts in the components of bodily act, speechly act, and mindly act. Act of the body, act of the speech, act of the mind. So Adhyatma tries to classify even our activities on the basis of body component, speech component and mind component. So the point is, the speech component is not coming in, which is one of the major kriyas of asana. What is meant by that? And how will it give the thought matter? How will it turn out the thought matter? So while we are in asanas, we are not just supposed to have body considerate, breath considerate, mind considerate conditions. Yeah, that is there. No doubt about it. No second opinion about it. But we need to have vachika kriya, speechly act. What is this speechly act? We are supposed to be commentators while the asanas are being done. We know that we are our role as a doers. Our role as doers in asanas, our role is as receivers in asanas. We receive the states, we receive the benefits, we receive the pains when the posture is wrong. We receive the balance, equanimity, when the posture is right. So we receive in a posture. So we are doers, we are dispensers, we are receivers. But being an adhyatmic act, it becomes an implication. It is implied that there must be speechly act. So I want you to develop this habit. For instance, now all of you take your asana. As an illustration, let us take Bharadvajasana, which almost all of you can be doing. So get to Bharadvajasana, either on the floor or on the chair. Now in Bharadvajasana, commence your doing of a posture. Now you are not just supposed to be doer of the posture. Also start, develop this habit gradually. Because you are not habituated to do it, it will take some time. Go for commentating. Give a running commentary of body, mind, breath interactions, body, mind, breath interplays. What you are doing, let it be part of your commentary. What the body is doing, let it be part of commentary. What the breath is doing, what the mind is doing, what are their interactions? This commentating act is very important. As I said, it is an educative process. For educative process, we need to be reading. We need to be writing. There is no education without reading and writing. So here, we must start commentating. Actions, responses, any resistances, any assistances, any participations, any involvement. Like in sports, there are commentators who give a running commentary on the sports. Similarly, we should develop this habit of giving running commentary. What the body is doing, what the breath is doing, what the mind is doing, what the inhalation is doing, what the exhalation is doing, what are the senses doing. So what are the limbs doing, what are the organs doing, organs of the body, organs of the mind. So the commentary should circumscribe and should start commentating on all these factors. So as you are in Bharadvajasana, of course you will be changing the sides on your own. Do not just do advertently, because otherwise we know that doing something advertently, you score some merit. So of course you must do advertently, you must do consciously, you must do sensitively, you must do with observation. But apart from that and over and above that also, understand your role as a commentator. So start giving running commentary, what the arms are doing, what have they done, what the back is doing, what the spine is doing, for what are they doing, what is the abdomen doing, pelvis doing, chest doing, what is done. So doer doing done, as I told you, this should be forming a part of your commentary, which is describing, articulating the doer doing and done, the body, mind, breath, doer doing and done, mutually doing for each other, you doing and you being done. So this should start becoming part of your commentating. That means you will read your dynamics. You will start reading the body, mind, breath, associated body, mind, breath doing. So in Bharadvajasana, don't just do advertently, don't just do sensitively, don't just do cognitively, and do not just do conatively, but see that there is commentating act. So you'll have to develop this habit. You can take a respite in between, because we are not used to giving a running commentary on our own pose, our own endeavor. We want to do something watchful. We want to do watchfully, we want to do sensitively, we want to do advertently. But additionally, develop this trait of commentating silently. So it is a silent commentary. So nothing will escape your commentary. So if nothing escapes your commentary, nothing escapes your observation. So commentating will also improve your observation, because you are observing to be commentating. So watch what the breath is doing: exhalative process, inhalative process, normal exhalation, deeper exhalation, normal inhalation, deeper inhalation, profound inhalation, profound exhalation, sharper inhalation, rarefied exhalation, rarefied inhalation. Wherever the post-exhalative retention comes, the retention, the Uddiyana Mudra. So you'll have to include all these in your act of commentary. So over a period of time, you will become better commentators on your dynamics. So when you are commentating, you will crystallize certain concepts, certain notions, certain ideas. Because when you have perceived something, you can't say there is no thought. When you have heard something, you can't say there is no thought. When you have sensed and experienced something, you can't say no thought was generated. So they will all be generating thought, but they need crystallization. So when you circumscribe body, mind, breath, their actions, their reactions, their responses, their participation, your action, your participation, your involvement, your responses, your reactions. So when you start articulating those by act of commentating, they will be all verbalized, and they will help you crystallize all those states and experiences, because they have to be verbalized. So that's why this Vachika Kriya is so important, which we have lost in the ultra-modern yoga, consumer yoga. Because consumer yoga only thinks of perfecting body, perfecting mind, that's all. There is no knowledge process. So in knowledge process, in educative process, we need to have crystallization of the concepts, notion, ideas. And when you verbalize by act of commentating, these things will be crystallized. These things, there will be ideations, and that is the thought matter. So you will realize that there is abundant thought matter. Now in your Bharat Vajasan, you can go for body set addressal and then commentate on the process of it. How is the body set addressal? What are the dynamics of body set addressal? What the associated body, mind, breath do for body set addressal? So that will be crystallized, rather than only accomplishing. If you just do it, you can accomplish. But start commentating, you will collect thought matter. Then go to breath set addressal. See how the body, mind, breath will be addressing the breath and breathing. And what will be the effect of it? What is the process of it? What is the consequence of it? What is the effect of it? So the act of commentating will help you crystallize these. They will be verbalized. They will become ideas, they will become notions, they will become concepts. When there is mindset addressal, what the body, mind, breath is doing for mind. So the act of commentating will open out the literacy aspect in yoga. Yoga is not just to be accomplished. You must be literate about yoga. You have to be literate about your embodiment. So it will give you literacy of the embodiment, literacy of dynamics of yoga, and literacy about the yoga itself. So this act of commentating will help you develop, crystallize various ideas, notions, concepts, precepts, and they will become thought matter. Now when there is thought matter, there is thinking, there is thinker, and then you can be going for that meditative activity. So the most important raw material for meditative activity in asana is vachika kriya, speechly act. So try to go by that. In your Bharatvajasana, go for various phases of asanas: doing, staying, maintaining, intensity, penetration, of freedom, settled condition. See, the commentating act will help you, give you crystallization of all this. You will crystallize rather than just going through. So also doing, learning, studying, observing, experimenting, having a thought process, analysis, synthesis, deliberation, reflection. So that also went with the commentating act. You will have crystallizations of thoughts. Only when the thoughts are well crystallized, you can go for meditative activity. If the thoughts are not well crystallized, you can never go for meditativity around a thought, with respect to a thought. The crystallization is important. And the act of commentating will help you develop this. The pop yoga has totally neglected this. Nowhere you are given any instructions about the speechly act, the vachikriya, running commentary. You should become good commentators on yoga. Then you will also become eloquent in yoga. You will become literate in yoga. So this vachikriya is so important, which will turn out enormous thought matter. And that meditativity pursuit can be facilitated. So this was a little more opening to the topic that we discussed yesterday. Now we will open out another point which I just introduced towards the end of the session, last session. I said Chitta Vritti Nirodha Yogaha. That is the definition of yoga. Now, I made a statement that these are not the Chitta Vrittis that you are getting now in your awakeful state. When we are awakeful, yoga doesn't restrain those. Restraining those is not really essentially yoga. So I said yesterday that these are vrittis in the internal realm. All these vrittis that you have perhaps construed, pramana, viparyaya, vikalpa, nidra, smriti, there is reference to an experience in awakeful state, object of awakeful state. The pramana, the cognition comes with regards to an object outside us. The valid knowledge of cognition is with regards to an object outside us. Illusions are with regards to object outside us. So we get the illusion with regards to object which is external to us. Similarly, vikalpa, verbal delusion. So in the illustrations which you come across in the books of yoga, they are all illustrations in the external realm. So pramana, viparyaya, vikalpa, nidra, smriti. So these are all with reference to awakeful state. And as I said, if the mind has to be restrained, then the best way is to go for dreamless sleep, have a good sleep. So it's a comprehensive scheme to have restraint of all those manovruttis. Definition is not manovritti nirodha yoga, but chitta vritti nirodha yoga. These are all manovruttis. Cognition, direct perception, inference, testimony, illusion, verbal delusion, nidra spruti. These all take place on psychological plane, psychomental plane. These are all vrittis which manifest in the brain. So those are all psychomental vrittis. Yoga is not speaking about restraint of those. Because a simple logic here. Do you want to restrain your mind and go to yoga? Or go to yoga and restrain your mind? We want to go to yoga and restrain our mind rather than restraining the mind and then go to yoga. Because then yoga restrains our mind. For us, yoga is the means to restrain our mind. So when you get into yoga, that means you must be in yoga to restrain your mind. The definition pertains to that. You must be in yoga, and then the restraint that takes place in yoga is spoken about here. Rather than the mental modulation which is before going to yoga or not having gone to yoga. So these are vrittis of the internal realm, not the vrittis of the external realm. It's not perception of the external realm. That will be restrained when you are fast asleep. Illusion will be restrained when you are fast asleep. Verbal delusion will be restrained when you are fast asleep. So psychomental vrittis are restrained when you are fast asleep. So when you get into yoga, you get into the internal world, which in fact is internal universe. It is microcosm. It's a universe inside. We have only world outside us. We have world outside us. We have universe inside us. So we are getting into internal universe when we start doing yoga, and then the restraint will take place there, which will be a unique restraint. So that is why it is chitta vritti nirodha rather than manovritti nirodha. But all translations in English will say that mental restraint is yoga, because there is no word for chitta in English. More proper word at given point in time will be mind stuff, the whole of mind. The mind is something peripheral aspect. It is tip of the iceberg, and the chitta is whole of the iceberg. How much of the part of the iceberg is under the water in the ocean, and how much the part of it as tip is above the ocean? It is nominal. It is minuscule part which is on the surface of the ocean, and that we call as tip of the iceberg, while the iceberg is huge under the water. So psychological mental mind is something referring to tip of the mind, not really the mind. It is the tip of our mind stuff. And the chitta which underlies it is huge. So chitta vritti nirodha means restraint of the entire mind stuff. And not just restraint of the tip of the iceberg of chitta. So, there is a big difference between the mind and chitta. Let me try to explain this to you with an example. See, we undergo different climatic conditions, weather conditions. In summer, the temperature soar to 40, 45 degrees in India. In winter, they dip down to 10 degrees, 8 degrees, 7 degrees. That's a huge difference. between the minimum temperature of winter and maximum temperature of the summer. Is that right? So we know how much difference it makes between the minimum temperature of winter and maximum temperature of the summer. It is a huge, huge difference. So it is said by oceanographers that if the average temperature of the ocean, average temperature of the ocean goes up by 1 degree, we will be all reduced to ash. All life, all manifestation on the planet, on the land, will be reduced to ash if average temperature of the ocean goes up by 1 degree. And if the average temperature of the ocean goes down by 1 degree, the entire creation on the planet, Earth, the land part of it, or even the water part of it, will be banished. Just 1 degree of temperature, average temperature of the ocean going down by 1 degree, we will have frozen condition on the rest of the planet. Ocean won't be frozen by 1 degree, but rest of the things will be frozen. So 1 degree of temperature of the ocean changing in the environment of the planet can cause a huge difference, total annihilation on either side. Either side there will be total annihilation. What is ocean on the planet? Where the temperatures on the planet can go up and down with a range of 20, 30, 40, 50 degrees. That doesn't happen to ocean, average temperature of it. So it's a huge thing for average temperature of the ocean to go up or down just by 1 degree. So chitta is something like ocean. The mind is something like terrain. Sometimes the angry mind goes for boiling temperature. Sometimes the mind goes to frozen condition. So mind can freeze, mind can boil. This cannot happen to ocean, that sometimes the ocean will boil and sometimes the ocean will be frozen. There's no need. Just 1 degree here and there, it will be total change in the planet. No life will be there. So that's how 1 degree of temperature and ocean are related. Chitta is similarly something like ocean of the mind. Little ups and downs in here really don't create big rufflings on the whole mind stuff. But our mind can be going for toss. It can be tossing. But the whole of the mind stuff is like ocean. And yoga speaks of chitta vritti nirodha, not mano vritti nirodha. It is not with reference to psychological mind, empirical mind, temporal mind. It is with reference to chitta. So in the internal realm, we get typical kinds of vrittis. Now those vrittis have to be identified, and then as your yoga evolves towards becoming, you know, quintessential asanas, quintessential pranayama, there will be enormous restraint, significant restraint taking place in the internal realm. So in yoga, once you are through the gateway of asanas, gateway of pranayama, you are in the internal realm. And then you will be restraining the vrittis or the internal realm. So we should be aware of those vrittis. What are those vrittis? So the vrittis in the internal realm are totally different. Another example I will give you. Suppose you are angry with someone. What is the manifestation? You can be angry with your loved ones, your hated ones. You know how anger differently manifests. known people, unknown people. You can get angry with known people, unknown people, your kith and kin, or related to you, not related to you, your friends, your allies, your aliens. So the anger manifests differently. On that, on one hand, see, how is this anger? You are angry with someone. You are angry because of someone. You are angry on someone. How is the anger? On the other hand, if you are angry with yourself, what's the difference between manifestation of anger when you are angry with you? So it's a different manifestation of the anger. Similarly here, pratyaksha anumana agama or pramana viparya vikalpa with reference to external world is one kind of manifestation, function, process, consequences. And whatever vrittis come in internal realm are different vrittis. So we must start identifying those vrittis. How are those vrittis? What are those vrittis? How is the pramana that ever there? What is the pramana vritti in the internal realm? It is not like it is in external realm. This is rose, therefore I am knower of the rose. It's a valid perception. The rose is external to you. Now here in the internal realm, the chitta vrittis are different. You don't have an object for the vritti to be formulated. So these are internal vrittis. So where is the pramana in the internal realm? Where is any viparya in the internal realm? Where is vikalpa in the internal realm? And where is nidra spruti in the internal realm? So therefore, these chitta vrittis are totally different. And these chitta vrittis are restrained in your process of even doing asanas. That depends upon your degree of proficiency. Less proficient, imagine what vrittis will you restrain. If you are more proficient, what vrittis will you restrain? So yoga speaks of restraining of those vrittis, not the vrittis of a wakeful state. Because basically you are in the internal realm. You have everything internal subjective objects. You, yours, in you are the objects. You, yours, in you are the instruments. You, yours, in you are subjective entity. Like in any external chitta vritti, you have a subjective entity, you have an objective entity, you have an instrumental entity. Three together help you turn out some vritti of the nature of pramana, viparya, vikalpa, nidra, smriti. In the internal realm, understand the unique condition. You, yours, and in you are manifesting in the form of objects of vritti, subjects, subjective entity in the vritti, as well as the instrumental entities in the vrittis. So we need to become familiar with this vritti world inside us. We are aware of vritti world outside us. Now we need to become aware of the vritti world inside us and see how yoga will be restraining those depending upon our caliber, depending upon our proficiency, depending upon our depth of penetration. So when you have penetrated, the restraint will be on very inner plane, internal plane. If you are not sufficiently penetrated, it will be more on peripheral plane. So the depth is important. And all these things will generate different kinds of chitta vrittis, like body set addressal, breath set addressal, mind set addressal. Doing, staying, maintaining, getting settled and quickly getting absorbed. Doing, learning, studying, experimenting, getting settled, getting absorbed. So these will be all different vrittis. So for every phase, try to identify the vrittis in the internal realm. What are the vrittis in a doing phase? What are the doing the vrittis in the staying phase? There'll be difference. So doing vrittis, staying vrittis, maintaining vrittis, penetration vrittis, efficacy vrittis, settlement vrittis, get absorbed vrittis, absorbed state and vrittis. Similarly, doing, learning, studying, understanding, analyzing, comprehending, experimenting, observing, and then getting settled, then going for absorption. So these will be different vrittis. And these vrittis are restrained in the process of asanas. You understand? So it is unique realm of object, subject, instrument. It is one matter which is going into the realm of objectivity, going into the realm of instrumentality, going into the realm of subjectivity. So it's a different vritti world, very fascinating vritti world when you have entered the, what you call as the portal. When you have entered the outer gate, when you have entered the portal, it is a fascinating kind of matter for analyzing, comprehending, and having a thought process over it. And the commentating act is so important here, because that will help you crystallize all this. It will give you enormous thought matter and suitable thought matter for meditativity. So yesterday I just made a passing kind of mention that chitta vritti nirodha means not the vrittis of the external realm but of the internal realm. That is what is yoga. And that is what will be more essential aspect of yoga rather than run up to yoga. In the run up to yoga, quite on your mind. If the mind is turbulent, if the mind is agonized, if the mind is vexed, so you see that you manage it, which is all in the run up to yoga. So in run up to yoga, try to regulate or restrain or manage the psychomental mind. Until that time, yoga will not really, you will not reach the portal of yoga, outer gate of yoga. So once you enter the outer gate, then you have so many enclosures within. Each enclosure has different gate, different gates and different realm of vrittis. So understand how this, the definition of yoga is to be understood. Restraining this tormented mind is not yoga. There are so many ways to restrain this tormented mind. Take a swallow analgesic pill, painkiller, or any kind of drug. So you will overcome your body pain, even the mental agony. There are drugs in psychiatry. A psychiatrist will give you some drugs. Why do you need this means of yoga? It is all run up to yoga, which are to manage. And in essential yoga, these are different management or restraints of chitta vrittis. So this is what I wanted to open out yesterday when I just made a passing reference to chitta vritti nirodha, and that vrittis in the internal realm are different. I think that is enough for the day. Thank you very much. Namaskar.